My, my, what a beauty.
Oh, William, thank you.
Oh, I was talking about this.
Oh.
And we have another beauty of a show for you next, right here on Garden Time. Welcome to Garden Time. Now, Judy, you know you are my own real true beauty, right?
Oh, and you're beautiful too. Thank you.
We are out at Al's in Woodburn, and almost it seems like every garden center is just chocked full of really beautiful plants right now.
And you know, it's not too late to get planting in your garden. Just remember to keep them well watered for the rest of the season. And speaking of plants, we'll be out at the Street of Dreams talking to a landscaper about all the plants that he used in the landscape out there.
We're also going to be showing you a recipe about using fresh fruit out at Smithberry Barn.
But first, some summer watering tips.
So I'm standing here with Chris, who is part of the Regional Water Providers Consortium. And Chris, today we're going to be talking about a lot of things, but certainly lawns, because I think in most humans' minds, we see a brown lawn and we think that that's terrible, it's bad, those people aren't good gardeners, why don't they take care of their place?
Sure.
But let's talk about that a little, because really, it's not that bad, is it?
No, it's not that bad. And in fact, over the years, I've seen more and more people going towards letting their lawns go dormant, because they don't die. They're just going dormant in the summer.
And people need to realize that it's not because you're a lazy gardener or you don't want a beautiful home, but as you know, as money is money.
Sure.
And to keep a lawn green, how long do you think you would have to water to make it green?
Well, we suggest to people that 1 inch a week on your lawn works really, really well. Of course, when it gets really, really hot and really dry, you're going to be wanting to put down more water than that. But it does take a significant amount of water to keep those lawns green. And the bigger lawn you have, you know, the bigger the more water you're using.
And you just want to make sure that people know that just because it's brown doesn't mean it's dead. Because Lord knows the weeds keep coming
up. Yes. No problem there. Yeah, the weeds really like it. And no, it's dormant. This, you know, the traditional type of grass that we use for lawns in this area, its nature is to go dormant when it gets too hot outside. And obviously when there's not enough rain to keep them green. So that's what happens.
And that is not to say that you can't still have beautiful flower beds, edible stuff. Because I noticed here in this lawn, two things have struck me. Certainly right around where clearly there is water being placed, where the beds are, there is a little line of green. But then here in front, this seems, do you water this whole thing? Because there's a lot of thing here, but it's not water that keeps this green, is it?
No, it's actually the shade coming from the roof and the eave of the house. In fact, right here, you can just see a line.
It's very clear.
And if you spent the whole day here and sat on the front porch, you would see that this is completely shaded during the summertime. So this stays really green. You know, I do water these beds, but the beds specifically, and you get a little bit of trailing out. So around the beds, it stays kind of green.
Even at this one up here, I've noticed that around the whole structure, this is kind of a kidney-shaped bed, about 3 feet out, there is some moisture. So that's not because you're watering out here necessarily.
No,
that's just the way the soil's working.
Yeah, exactly. It's just because this gets a good amount of water. But even at that, with these beds here, I didn't start watering until the last weekend of June.
Really?
And yeah, I let it go. And then what I've done is I just set a small sprinkler out here for about 15 minutes. Move it 15 minutes. I'm very specific to make sure it's just watering the beds, you know, just not anything and everything. And it's working great. The mulch.
I was going to say, this looks like fresh mulch.
Yeah. The mulch is amazing in, you know, keeping that soil moist and keeping the soil cool. I mean, it's, you know, what that does for the plants is just considerably different.
Well,
than if
Chris,
you didn't
the evidence of that is the area where the house is shaded, that's greener too.
Yeah.
And but there's also some edible stuff. So let's run back to the backyard real quick and take a look at some more stuff, shall we?
Yeah.
Okay, Chris, now we have walked back to the backyard, and right off the bat, I've noticed that you clearly have made some choices about what plants go where.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that?
Mm-hmm. Well, every plant has its own particular need, and you know, that's light exposure, that's soil types, that's watering needs. And so what I try to do is it all of those plants, you know, that have like needs go together in the same place. So, you know, for instance, this right here, I did a little raised bed to put the vegetables in because they do need a little more water than everybody else. And so that tends to work out really well here. Nice exposure for the sun, of course, you know, putting your taller plants to the back and everything. Along here, these plants right here get a nice shot of the mostly morning sun, midday, but then once it starts to get really, really hot, they start to get shaded by the tree and then the fence and everything. And again, you know, I just don't water anything around here that much unless it unless it's bearing fruit for me. I don't put a lot into it. But I most definitely am very mindful about, again, I think most important things is know your light exposure, know your soil and the watering needs, and then get all of those plants together.
And it's okay to fail once in a while, isn't it? To learn.
Because I do all the time.
So do I.
Oh, without a doubt. I'll be like, oh, that's not right. Dig it up and put it somewhere else. Yeah, don't feel like that's a failure. That's a learning experience. And
certainly
that's
is.
The fun and
that's
the love
fun of gardening.
Yeah. Exactly.
We're clearly saying the same thing here.
Yeah, well, the labor of love.
It is. It is a labor of love. Well, you know, there is so much to know about watering and the best way to water and how to use our water wisely. That's a real important thing for all of us to learn. So as you're learning about plants, you can also learn about water. We certainly tell you to go to gardentime.tv. We'll click you over to their website. They have a host of information on their website. So really, this has been interesting. Thank you so much, Chris.
Well, thank you for coming. I appreciate it.
Garden Time is brought to you by Portland Nursery, a passion for plants, a nursery for plant people.
Do you want to be green? Do the easy stuff first. Hi, I'm Sarah from Portland Nursery. The U.S. House Energy and Commerce Committee says for every dollar spent on a shade tree, you can save $5 on cooling, blocking the penetrating heat in the summer and allowing the warm rays through in the winter. Dollar for dollar, there's no better energy and money saver than a good deciduous shade tree. Portland Nursery's professionals can help you make the perfect selection. Portland Nursery, a passion for plants, a nursery for plant people.
If you build it right. Build it to last. Don't just build it for yourself. Build it for the next generation. Build it with Par Lumber. And keep building the Great Northwest.
Par Lumber is celebrating 85 years as a local, family-owned company. From our house to yours, we send a heartfelt thank you.
Well, it is the first day of the Street of Dreams in Lake Oswego, and I'm at the Atterbury House with the landscaper, Chris Merton from Merton & Sons. You know, this is really a beautiful landscape. So how do you start? Do you work with, you know, designers, other designers, or do you work with the clients?
We actually sit down, you know, several months before, and we do a walkthrough with the homeowner, you know, of what they're looking for, if we're going to do hardscapes, driveway pavers, water features, as you see behind us, and we start the process at that point.
Yeah, you want to make them happy because they're going to be here for a long time enjoying your work.
That's right.
Yeah, so when you do water features like this, it's like, it looks like a lot of work, and I'm sure it is, so, but it's more than that. It's like the whole thing, you make it water feature, but with plants around it.
That's correct, yeah. We do, we come in and do the design around the water feature of, you know, pick a unique hillside. We decide where it's going to go, how large the pond is going to be for the homeowner, you know, to fit their needs, and then what type of rock we're going to install, the pumps, the liner, the filter, how many water features on the site. Obviously, we showcase our work here at the Street of Dreams and you know, try to make it work for everybody.
Yeah, you know, everybody comes and brings their beautiful work here, and you've done that many years. You've been here at the Street of Dreams for many years, so it's cool to see it also this year.
Yeah, we've actually, this is our sixth showing in the Street of Dreams. We started back in 2007 and we've won five awards out of the six shows, and we enjoy doing it.
Ah, great. Well, you had another water feature that we want to showcase and hear about, so let's go over and look at that one.
Sounds great.
So Chris, this water feature behind me is kind of different. So what is its exact name?
It's a water quality facility, and its purpose is to take the rooftop water and the downspout water, the driveway water, and have it funneled into this system. The system itself is designed with a pond liner, and it it has a soil blend in the bottom. It has river rock in the bottom. It's got hedge plants and sedges that are basically made to absorb the water, and its design is specifically by rooftop and calculated on the size of the water quality facilities, on how big the roof is. There's a certain square footage that the city requires.
So really, you're really helping the water get off of the site in a good way to get back into the aquifers, get back into the water system clean and not cause any trouble.
That's correct.
You know, this is really interesting because there's actually two of them here. There's one closer to the house and one behind us. So it's really interesting that's really worked into the whole landscape here.
Yeah, it does. The city of Lake Oswego required two of them this year. Generally, each home gets one. And so I think they were concerned about, you know, with all the size of the homes, having a lot of water coming down.
Right. Well, down for the future, we do have a rainy climate here, so you want to take care of it so everyone's safe, but then also the water quality is safe for all of us.
That's correct.
So really, we're seeing that a lot in gardens and in municipalities these days. So was that a challenge for you, something new for you?
No, we've been building them for years. When they've developed subdivisions, they've put in water quality facilities and bigger expansions to catch the whole subdivision's water, where in this case, they're starting to put them in on every individual house. And so I think it's a better way to go. I think that it's going to filter out the water. When we do have those big rainstorms, as you can see the top of the pipe, when it gets too full, then it will go back into the system, but that's on a very rare occasion.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, it is really an interesting and beautiful site. So you can come to Street of Dreams until the end of August, and for more information, go to gardentime.tv. We'll click you over that website. So come on out and check out all the beautiful areas. Thanks so much.
Hey, thank you.
For our tip of the week, we have a great idea for you.
Okay, wait a minute. Now tell me what gardening tip is going to come from a kid's inflatable swimming pool.
William, start blowing it up and I'll tell you all about it. William, that's enough.
It's not full yet.
But you know, for this tip of the week, you only need a little bit of water to take care of the plants while we're on vacation.
That's really true. Now here's what we think about this. You get a kid's pool, you put a couple of inches of water in, that's all you really have to do. Make sure that it's in the shade, and then while you're on vacation,
there we go.
Set the pots in.
You know, this is just a great way while you're away to have them watered. You don't have to rely on your neighbors or friends down the block, and so sometimes they forget. So this one will be on duty 24/7.
Using a child's little swimming pool to keep your plants healthy while you're on vacation, that's our tip of the week.
Garden Time is brought to you by Capital Subaru, your way on the parkway.
I have been a Capital Subaru customer for 15 years, and one of the main reasons is because they treat me well and I want to shop local. The service department is excellent and I always feel like I'm taken care of here. In fact, they call me now even after I've driven off the lot to remind me to come in and get my car washed. That's service. One of the reasons why I like coming to Capital Subaru, actually, they have the dog area, and I can just walk my dog around the whole area and we can enjoy the outside. I got it my way on the parkway.
Garden Time is going to Ireland. Join William and Judy as they tour the Emerald Isle, visiting some outstanding private and public gardens. For more information, go to gardentime.tv and click on the airplane.
I'm at Smithberry Barn with Joelle, and Joelle, you have another tasty treat for us today. What are we making?
Today we're making a peach raspberry tart.
Oh, what a great combination. That is wonderful.
It's a rustic tart, so it's really easy. We're going to start with our dough, which I've partially started here. And basically what we're doing is we're looking for about a 14-inch square piece of dough, and I've put it on a piece of parchment here to make it easy to transfer and move around.
That's a great tip, because how else would you get it off of this nice plastic piece
exactly.
Onto the cookie sheet?
So basically we're going to take this to the fridge. I'm going to go chill this while we start working on our fruit.
And you know, I see that you have another disc of dough right here that's in plastic. So really, you can make a couple of batches of it to have in the fridge or in the freezer to ready go at another time.
Exactly. So this is how that started. We kind of cheated and skipped forward.
But that's okay.
This is our chilled disc of dough, and then we put it on the parchment. We roll it out to the right size.
That's perfect.
And you can make some ahead and freeze them and use them at any time.
Right. And so you have some tricks for us for peaches too?
Exactly. So basically with a peach, you're looking for it to be ripe, and you've gone ahead and sliced this for us, and then you spin it and peel it.
Now that's easy.
So this is a freestone peach, which is what we like. We like to be able to easily pop that out. And then all we're going to do is peel off the skin.
Okay.
And slice it up. And you can see we have a bowl full of already sliced peaches. It is peach season right now, which we don't grow peaches here, but we have a great farmer, one of our neighbors, who grows the peaches. And so we sell them here, ready picked. And we love them with raspberries. So right now
it
is raspberry, late season raspberries for us.
And I did notice that there's some bruises on here, so you don't have to use the pristine peaches.
Exactly.
You can use them with a little bit of bruising.
This is the best way to use those little bruised peaches. And it also helps us to know that they're ripe, so if they have a little bit of bruising, that's all the better, because you know it's a nice juicy peach.
Yeah.
You can see the juice
very
dripping
sweet
down my hands, and I'm making a little bit of a mess here, but that's what we want, because then we know they're really good.
It's your kitchen, so we can do that. And so I see that we have some of these raspberries. We're just going to put them in a bowl.
We're going to sprinkle them in there.
Alrighty.
And then we already have ready our flour sugar mixture, which the nice thing about this kind of tart is you can actually use any kind of fruit mixture you'd like. And I just adjust my amount of sugar based on the tartness or the sweetness of the fruit. Oh, we're going to do some lime. We forgot
about that. I know, I forgot. It was my job. I was supposed to do zesting.
Go ahead and zest a little.
I'm going to be zesting. But we're using more than lime than just the zest. We're going to use the juice too.
So go ahead and let's cut that.
Okay. And so would we do the whole lime then?
We're going to just do the juice of half
of
the lime.
All right.
And I just squeeze it right over the top.
All right.
Make sure I don't get any seeds in there.
All right.
And then all we're going to do is stir this up.
All right. So we're going to finish combining this and getting the fruit ready, and we'll be back in just a minute.
Great.
Okay, Joelle, the fruit is all ready.
Thank you. So we've taken our dough out of the refrigerator, and we're basically just going to pile it right here in the middle of the dough.
I love this, that there's no special pan. I don't have to go buy something, and really it's kind of free form.
Exactly. So the idea here is that you can do pretty much whatever you would like, and it does not have to be perfect. You're basically just looking for, a circle.
Make it even, sure.
And then we need a couple of inches on the outside, about 2 inches all the way around. We're hoping to not leave any cracks in it so that it oozes around.
Yeah.
And all you do is you lift and kind of pleat.
Oh, that's so pretty.
Lift and pleat.
So now I see that you use these late season raspberries and peaches, but can we use other kind of combinations too?
You can use just about anything you would like. We use this with pears, we use it with blackberries and blueberries, we use it with frozen fruit. This is it assembled. It's just all nice and tucked in there.
Okay, and what temperature now and how long?
Before we do that, we're at 400 degrees, which you do need to do ahead because it takes a while to get up to that temperature.
All right.
And then we're taking a little bit of our melted butter and
just kind of putting it on
It on the edge of the crust. And if you want to start the sugar,
we're
just going to sprinkle that on the edge.
And that kind of just gives it a nice little browned edge to it.
Exactly. And then 400 degrees for about 40 minutes.
Oh, wow.
And you're going to be watching for it to start to brown a little bit around the edges and to get a little bit bubbly. And thank you, a little bit of butter dotted on top.
And we're ready to go.
All
right. Joelle, that looks so beautiful. I can't believe it. And it was so easy to do too, which I love. And I would love to watch that video while I make it, because then I feel so much more confident in how it's going to come out.
Well, good.
So you can go to Smithberry Barn website and see the recipe, and then also watch the video so that you can make this at home. Come out to Smithberry Barn and get your seasonal berries now through frost.
Exactly.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Standards prices are great. We've checked. They're very competitive. That's why we use them.
You don't have to waste time running around making phone calls. It's good to know when working with Standard that our staff doesn't have to spend incredible amounts of time searching for pricing.
And even with the clients that have checked around, they've always come back to Standard as being their best buy.
Since 1947, we set the standard. Standard TV and appliance.
So I'm in the charming little city of Knee Tarts, and I'm here with Ben Jacobsen, and you have a great company called Jacobsen Salt Co., right?
Yes.
Now, I need to know, what made a man go salt? That's what I'm going to get into.
It's definitely a little bit strange of a hobby. It really was harvesting salt for me was a hobby for about 3 years. Before I discovered how to make good salt, but I discovered good salt for the first time when I was living in Denmark, and then I moved to Norway, and moved back here to the U.S. and the region had evolved from a culinary standpoint, uh-huh. but a large part of that evolution was really driven by incredible ingredients.
Yeah.
But people were still buying salt from the UK or France or even Japan. And I lived in Portland and pointed west and said, there's a Pacific Ocean just 85 miles away from us.
Someone's got to be getting some salt from there.
Exactly. Why is nobody making great salt? And it was really just truly just kind of a head scratching moment, just kind of like, that's strange. And so that began about a 2.5 year process of trying to figure out how to make good salt. And
and you did that, not only did you really actually spend some time finding this specific area of where you wanted to withdraw the water from,
yeah.
And so it seems simple to my mind that you just put a machine into the ocean and you pull the water out, but that's really, this is where it starts at, isn't it?
This is right where it starts. And 2 years ago, 3 years ago now, I was literally hauling 5 gallon buckets of water into a rented U-Haul truck back to Portland and
oh my goodness.
Making salt there. And finally we're here, and I think it's arguably the cleanest bay on the west coast of America.
Well, now where we see where it starts from, let's walk up to the place here and look at more of the process, shall we?
Great, sounds good.
Okay, Ben, so we've walked 25, 30 feet right up here to this main part of the company where everything happens. Tell me then, go through the process of it. It comes through the pump system, and then what happens?
Yeah, so we filter the seawater as it comes in, and through a gravity-fed sand filter, and then we let the water settle for a little bit, and then we boil it, and we boil the seawater to remove the volume to a very specific salinity, but most importantly in this process is to remove the calcium. That if we left that calcium and magnesium in, it would give our salt a very bitter taste.
Really?
But when you taste our salt, it's very clean and briny,
yep.
and almost sweet in a way, and that's very deliberate. And so that's what we're going for.
And that's the calcium?
Exactly, yeah.
Wow.
So this is the calcium that, you can imagine tasting this, and it wouldn't taste very good.
No, it's not delicious.
Exactly. So it's we're working on, all sorts of other stuff, like a plant fertilizer, that is obviously largely calcium-based.
So you mean what you can do with this part of this process is that, and you're trying to figure out other ways to use that as well.
Exactly.
That's
our byproduct,
yeah.
Essentially. So it's we filter the seawater, boil it to remove the calcium, and then we move it to very shallow, custom-made, and unfortunately very expensive stainless steel evaporation pans.
Uh-huh.
And we let the salt crystals form in those pans very slowly, and it's a process that can't be rushed at all.
Yeah.
And then the salt crystals will form slowly and then fall to the bottom of the pan. And it's at that point that we will harvest the salt crystals, let them drain, and then dry, and then hand sort and hand pack every single crystal of salt that leaves our facility.
Wow.
And our testament to quality is that. I mean, it's... every flake of salt that leaves here is, has gone under our inspection, and we stand behind 110%.
Well, and here's what I think is interesting, because you mentioned that the salt forms the crystals and then they fall. You really can't rush that, because I've stood in there and watched them,
yeah.
And it's a process of all of a sudden you'll see one little cluster of them just kind of
float to the bottom. And what I found interesting too was in those brining parts, you can see the bottom. It's a very clear liquid that it's in.
Yeah, it's beautiful, really. It almost has the appearance of, like, you know, snowflakes falling down the bed.
It does. It's quite peaceful,
gorgeous.
Actually.
Totally, and it's my favorite part of the process because it's like kind of the culmination of so much the work that's gone into it. But at the root of it all is, you know, fire, water, and salt, and so it's still very primal. And we're the first company to harvest salt in the Northwest since Lewis and Clark, and that's just amazing.
Well, and then you also have, you started with just salt, but now you have a lot of flavors, don't you?
That's a tremendously fun part of the job, is coming up with new flavors. And we have a very flat organizational structure, so everybody comes up with new flavors. Our ops manager here gave garlic salt to everybody for Christmas in the company, and it was so good that we said, hey, can we make garlic salt with this recipe? And he said, absolutely. So we are, and it's the best garlic salt that's ever been. We have a Stumptown coffee salt, a rosemary salt that went on Burgerville fries, and a black garlic salt. We ferment our own black garlic and mix it in with the salt.
Now, just because you have gotten a tremendous name in the restaurant part of Portland area because of chefs that love your salt, but you know, the everyday person can buy it too. Where can
Absolutely.
People pick it up at?
We've been very fortunate to have that support with chefs, but also home cooks. And you don't have to be a great cook to use great salt.
Right.
I'm a very average home cook, and I make toast and eggs in the morning and finish it with flake salt, and it's that much better. And you can buy our salt at New Season, Zupans,
and they can also
Whole Foods.
Buy it at Whole Foods and get it online as well.
Online, at jacobsensalt.com and also in our tasting room in Southeast Portland.
Wonderful. Well, you know, this has been a delightful, delightful time spent here because you really get to see the process of some of the things that we often take for granted. And plus that it is so delicious, it just makes it all worth the while. So for more information, we always invite you to go to gardentime.tv. We'll click you over to their website, get some of this salt, and make your wonderful cooking even better. Thank you so much, Ben. This has been delightful.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much for watching the show today. Now remember, with all of this heat that's happening, you want to keep your gardens well hydrated.
And don't forget to keep yourself well hydrated too.
With a pinch of Jacobsen salt.
For more information about today's show, please go to gardentime.tv.
Thanks for spending time with us. We can't wait to do it all again next week, right here on Garden Time.
Garden Time is going to Ireland. Join William and Judy as they tour the Emerald Isle, visiting some outstanding private and public gardens. For more information, go to gardentime.tv and click on the airplane. The proceeding was a paid program of the Guston Creative Group and its sponsors.